Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory, glory to Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Welcome to church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Glory to Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus. Glory to Jesus. Glory to Jesus. Yes. Hallelujah. We're here in God's presence today. We're here afresh. We're here, you know, not according to tradition, but according to the leading of God at all times. And in this time and now, in this season, with whatever is going on in the world around us, we need God. We need His presence. We need His power. But above all, we need His words. We need His words. The Bible says, a man shall not live by bread alone. In other words, a man shall not live only by the word, by the food that we eat. Yes, food is meant to sustain us, to keep us, to sustain our health. But that's not what keeps us. That's not what holds us. That's not what gives us life in this time and generation. So in this time and generation, we need the word of God. We need the word of God. We need the word that God has given to us per time, per season. For man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of his mouth. Not the words of man, not the words of friends, not the words of family, not the words, not even the words, not just the words of a preacher, but the words of God. For man shall not live by bread alone. Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. What are the words that proceed out of the mouth of God? These are the words of life. What word keeps you going? What word gives you confidence? What word makes you want to hold on tenaciously to the power that God has given, or to the promises that God has given to you? What words? This is what is regarded or spoken out as the word of life. The word of life. The word of life. Jesus said, and I repeat it, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. How do we get the words? How do we hear the words that comes from God? In other words, it's not just even the preaching, but there is a word that you need to hear for the goal. There's a word that you need to receive for the now. There's a word in season. There's a word you need to take in season. There's a word you need to receive in season. There's a word for you per season. There's a word for you per time. There's a word for you per day. There's a word for you per moment. There's a word you need to hold on to tenaciously. This is what ignites you. This is what wants to make you live another day. Because in this present day and generation, in this present day and time, in this present hour, you cannot live by the words that men speak. You cannot live by the words of the television. You cannot live by the words of the radio. You can only live by the words of God. A man shall not live by bread alone, But by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. So what words are we listening to? What words are we hearing? The words that we hear is what becomes becomes a foundation for our imagination, becomes a foundation for what we become, becomes a foundation for what we put out, our output. Because the Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart of man, his mouth speaks. In other words, when you speak, when we hear you, we know where your heart is. We know if you are high in spirit. We know if you are meek in spirit. We know if you are low in spirit. The word of life. The word of life. If Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds. If Jesus said so, then how do you intend to go on in this day without having a word? Without living by a word? The Bible says, which is actually our context for today, is in the book of John, John chapter 6, verse 63. The Bible's meant. I'm going to read it to you from the contemporary English version. John 6:63. It says, the Spirit is the one that gives life. Human strength can do nothing. Now, this is the part. He says, the words that I have spoken to you are from the life-giving Spirit. Now, let me come and read to you in the King James version. I deliberately read that translation first, so you understand. So you hear that part. Life-giving Spirit. The words that I have spoken to you, they are life-giving Spirit. Ah, King James Version says, it is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words, Jesus said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. The other translation says, the word spoken to you is a life-giving spirit. In other words, these words that we speak, this was, okay, I don't want that. Jesus said, now I'm going to begin to give examples of how you know that you the words, these words, they are full of life such that it can create, it can destroy, it can bow down, it can plant, it can give birth. How? That was. These words, Jesus said, the words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. In the contemporary English translation, he says, these words spoken are a life-giving spirit. In other words, they carry, they possess that which, when it is spoken, it becomes what do we speak? How do we speak? When do we speak? If Jesus said, the words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. That's what we read in John 6:63. And I read from another translation, the contemporary English version. It says, the words spoken, Jesus talking, these words are life-giving. Pray that you catch this. These words, they are life-giving. These words, they are life-giving. words, Jesus was once saying, he says, these words, they are life-giving. In other words, these words that I speak to you, they carry the potency of birthing. Birthing, no wonder in the beginning, is God said, let there be. Let there be. And there was. He only spoke. He said, let there be, and there was. He spoke. Can you please explain to me in your mental state of mind and your science how you speak and then there is a happening? If not, that God has created or put power inside the words that we speak. The words that we speak are not just words. The words that we speak are not just words spoken at any point. They are not just ordinary words. It doesn't matter if you spoke out of love or out of anger. It doesn't matter if you spoke that which is right or that which is not right. That's why the Bible says, on the day of judgment, you give account for every word you spoke. Either you spoke it in an idle manner, in an uncare, in a way that you didn't care about, or in a way that you were conscious that these words that I am speaking, these words that I am speaking, that Jesus said it does not mean it's for Jesus alone. That Jesus said it does not mean that, oh, it was because it was Jesus. Haven't you checked your life? That the words that you spoke negatively to yourself, either then or now, you are seeing the fruit of the negativity of the words you speak. This is why you need to be careful. Jesus said, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. The words that I speak, they are spirit and they are mind. This same spirit, this same attribute, this same character is in us today, because the Bible says he has formed us in his image, such that what we speak, that was why in the Garden of Eden, after God created, he now brought it before Adam, and he said, what is this? The Bible says, and whatsoever Adam named them, that is what they are to take. So Adam named many things. Adam gave many things names. That is why when it came to the point of Adam having a helper, a helpmate, a wife, another like him, he didn't make a mistake. Why? Because him who made him in his image gave him his mind. Image is not your outward appearance of you as a white man, a red man, a black man, or a blue man. No, but him in your spirit. The spirit of God is on the inside of you. The spirit of God is in your genealogy. The spirit such that when you speak, it will be. But some of us today, we are not speaking according to how we should speak. Some of us don't even understand what it means to speak, or how we should speak, or where we should speak, or what we should speak. Of course, you cannot know how to speak right if you are disconnected from the source of life itself. The source of life itself is him who made us in his image. Jesus now came and made it clearer to us. In John 6:63, he said, the words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. And the contemporary English translation was trying to make us understand, trying to break it down to our modern day English by saying, the words spoken to you, they are life-giving. They are a life-giving spirit. In other words, words spoken is a spirit. Why would the words we speak be a spirit? Why would the words that we are speaking, why we need carry spirit on the life of the Spirit, I will tell you one of the reasons. One of the reasons is because this life that we are in, this life that we are living in, let me tell you something. It's not because of what you know, or who you know, or your knowledge, but it's because of what God gives you to know. Come, let me tell you something. These words that we speak, when we speak it, we don't know how far it goes, or how much it travels, or how much it works. We don't even know. Have you read, for those of you that have read, and for those of you that have not read, in the Bible, in the days of Jesus, do you know that there was no situation that they brought to him that he said, "Oh, you are spondylosis, names that are being given our time and generation." Why? Because all those things, anything that fasting is sour to your body and makes you uncomfortable, is a spirit that wants to render you useless and render you not to be able to do that thing God has apportioned for you to do. So what you do is you speak to that spirit. And because that is a spirit, you can only speak to it as a spirit, not as empty words. That's why the Bible says, and Jesus cast the devil out. There was a child who had epilepsy. In this modern day and in this modern world, I am sure the word or the name epilepsy was given by men. But because there's a spirit behind it, Jesus rebuked the spirit. And the Bible says, and the spirit threw the boy on the floor, and the boy convulsed. He convulsed like he's having the epileptic fit again. But the evil spirit that was causing this ease, this comfort in the body of this child of God, the demon left with a noise, screaming out. Why? Because it's a spirit. A friend was telling me about another person who has been going to the doctor for a while for a particular medical issue. Something was wrong with this person's part of the body. They gave it a name. They began to treat it. Then it got to a point. They said, I'm talking about in the United States of America. I'm not talking about the third world country. I'm talking about the country where we have developed mind intellectually, where we have medical giants in the medical field. They said to this person, it's not what we think is wrong with you. Maybe it's something else now. So they now are leaving this person's, probably this thing was affecting the leg. They say, no, it's not the leg, it's the shoulder. Because they don't even know. It's a spirit that needs to be spoken to. It's a spirit that needs to be addressed. A spirit that needs to get up and say, in the name of Jesus, out, you foul spirit, you foul demon of hell. But if you do not come to the understanding that all these things, they are spirits, you will not be able to walk in the capacity that Jesus gave to us, saying, whatsoever. The thing comes to understand that everything you deal with, or everything dealing with you, every Satan trying to set you back is a spirit that you need to address. I never saw Jesus at any point in time in the Bible give crutches to somebody who cannot walk. I never saw Jesus give hearing aid to somebody who cannot hear. I never saw Jesus prescribe surgery for somebody who cannot speak, or for a mentally retarded, or someone that is mentally sick. I never saw Jesus say this person should be referred to the psychiatric ward. No, instead, Jesus rebuked the spirit. You found demon spirit. As a matter of fact, as soon as Jesus showed up, before he said everything, the Bible says the demons begin to tremble. They begin to say to him, "What are we to do with you, Son of God?" So they know him as Son of God, but not their own Lord. There's a difference between what is Lord and Savior. And there's a difference between that. So they say, even the demons know him and they tremble. So that somebody who does not know God knows that Jesus is a powerful messenger, the only one by whom you can receive salvation and you go into eternal life. No other way. Jesus never gave anybody hearing aid. Jesus never referred anybody to the psychiatric world. No! Jesus, never told anybody to go for counseling. And I know that tonight some people are going to feel uncomfortable, but it's the truth. Either you like it or not, the truth remains the truth. He gave us one who, he said, will teach you all things. He will lead you into all truth. The problem is we are not calm enough, not patient enough to sit at the feet of Jesus like Mary in our privacy and receive from him. What is my problem? Help me, Jesus. I was in Philadelphia, September 2018, preparing for God of the Bad Boys in one of the temples of Philly. And then they started to talk, a nurse, a man, of course, but nurse, was talking about somebody who worked at his place of work. Who is a counselor? A counselor. Paid to be a counselor. But he committed suicide. He used overdose of hard drug. That's a counselor that some people go to, sit down, and receive from or hear from, but cannot help himself. That tells you that this is a spiritual journey. This is a spiritual battle. Paul said, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and rulers of darkness in high places." That person annoying you is not the one that is annoying you. It is just, that person is just a medium that has given himself or herself over to the devil to be used as a tool. So do not hate that person. Hate the spirit behind every negative attitude that person is giving. Do not hate somebody who is prostituting. Hate the spirit behind her prostituting her body. Do not hate the adulterer. Hate the spirit behind the man making him an adulterous person. Why? It's a spirit you need to contend with. Jesus, that's the reason why he said, the words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. He even said, this written logos, in other words, You can read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation like a storybook and not get the spirit, the revelation behind the story which you are reading. So that is the reason why when you are studying, you are not reading like you are reading a storybook. You are meditating, assimilating, and praying at the same time, asking for the spirit behind every word. Jesus said, the letter kill it. He said, this logos, this written word, it doesn't give any life. But the words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. These words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. That is exactly what you need in this season and in this time. Why? For you are not resting against flesh and blood. You are resting against principalities and powers of darkness in high places. God said, I fought the beast of Ephesus. Wait. God did not come down from heaven to meet with Moses when they were in the Red Sea. God only told Moses, stretch your rod. In fact, he came out the moment the words are spoken. He comes with power. But some of us have received words of power and have not let this power live into our life. How? We have refused to believe this word of life. A prophet, a young prophet that was written in the Bible. The Bible says a young prophet was sent to go by God to go and prophesy against a particular altar. He only went there and spoke words. So, so, and so. God said the Lord. And this is what will happen to you from Genesis, Exodus, through to Revelation. You don't see just the prophets. Even the ones that stand before God, not all of them carry sword. We never had that Samuel went to war. That Samuel spoke from time to time were words. Isn't that what he said to Saul? When Saul pulled at his garment and the garment torn, he said to Saul, this same way that this garment is torn, that's the same way the kingdom is taken away from you. Did you not have one? Be careful who you are around, because some people speak some words around you that becomes a negative impartation upon your life. These are the words we call curses. Curses. Some people are even carrying so much curses in their life that you watch and learn with them, you begin to share in their curse. Why? Because God orders your step. He will tell you where to go, where not to go. That's not my concentration tonight. My concentration is this. What words do you speak? Are you speaking the words? What words are you speaking? When you speak, do you just speak? I'm not talking about when you speak, but whereby you are disconnected from God. I am speaking about when you know you are connected to God. And you speak, you don't spend hours in prayers. No, you don't give you one word. The Bible says, a still small voice. A still small voice. David said, Lord, should I pursue? Should I pursue? And he spoke, pursue. You will overcome and recover of what was spoken. But this word, where words of life, word of life, word of life, what is your word of life? What word of life are you holding on to? I am a living example of the manifest of different words of life spoken from one time to the other, from one season to the other in my life. And if you are a recipient of words of life, have you allowed these words to work for you or work against? No wonder Paul said, after speaking, after preaching, after teaching, after explaining the mysteries of John's gospel, I put myself under so that I will not be a cast away. I will not be lost from what I have preached or what I have taught or what I am teaching. For the words that we speak, they are life. As I'm speaking right now, these words are forming spirits into as many people that are here right now or that will hear. It's forming, it's empowering you, it's energizing you, it's inspiring you, it's quickening your body. Now, because they are not just ordinary words, they are words that are giving life, life-giving words. Did you read where it is written that he sent his word? He did not leave a place. The Lord sent his word, and his word gave them power. Jesus stood not by the side of the dead body or the carcass or the corpse, the degenerating body of Lazarus, the body that was smelling. Jesus did not even see. Jesus was far outside the cave, for crying out loud, how did he say, Lazarus, come forth? He spoke, and then these words, that their spirit, they began to walk, they began to move, and they found the body of Lazarus, and everybody to bed, what they say is, this word will weaken your mortal bodies. He says, this same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead will quicken your mortal body. What is it that your body is going through physically right now? Speak the words of life. Say to yourself, I am life. I am the life of God in me. When you study the scriptures, when you come across declarations of words of life, and the words drop out to you, that means that's your word. Take hold of it. Pause. Stop reading. And begin to speak those words. Begin to speak those words. Begin to soak yourself into those words. Soak your business. Soak your marriage. Soak your life. The words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. No wonder. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 18, verse 21, it says, the power of life and death is in the tongue. Yet that no devil will eat the fruits. The fruits can be negative and the fruits can be positive. What fruits of the what are the fruits of your lips? Did you speak a word that scattered your marriage? Did you speak a word that drove your wife away? Did you speak a word that drove your husband away? Did you speak a word that sent missiles into the enemy's camp to deliver somebody that had been held bound? He sent his word. If you read Genesis, the Bible says, God, the voice of God comes in the cool of the evening, walking in the garden. The voice, that is the word that we are speaking. That's the word that you carry. That's the word that is on the inside of you. But the words will not carry any power if you are disconnected from the power source. It's like unplugging the power source of this facility right now from the main power supply. This whole place goes dark. That does not mean that the city is darkness. It just means that the people in this facility have decided to unplug, and there is nothing they do in darkness that will fire. It can only fire the light. Light dispels darkness. So, first thing first, stay connected to the source. Jesus, he says, I am the vine. You are the branch. So without me, you can do nothing. He said, the Holy Spirit will teach you. He will remind you what you need to speak. There are times I will sleep and I will have once in a while a contending a contending dream where I am contending for a place or something is trying to fight against me in my sleep. And then my lips will begin to speak words that I did not prepare for. Why? Because the words have been soaked into my spirit when there was no battle. So when battle came, I didn't start to ask that good people, where is my Bible? Where's my Bible? So that I can find a scripture to know. Well, you are the carrier of God's presence. You are the ark of God. Out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. He says, you will open your mouth and I will feel it. But are you connected? Are you consistent? Is it only once in a while when there's a need? Is it only once in a while when there's a problem? That's when you remember to pray. That's when you remember to communicate with the one whose breath is on the inside of you. When something is beginning to look confusing, that's when you decide to fast. And you say, oh, because something's coming, I'm fasting for some days. Did you fast to say thank you, Lord? Did you ever fast to worship him? Just fasting, saying, Lord, today I'm staying off food just to worship him. Not to supplicate. Always begging for something. Your children, your physical children that you gave birth to, do they need to come and be begging you to give them something before they give you, or they just come in love? Why? There is a connection. The words that you speak. Now, the problem about this world is even if they are not speaking life, the other, you are speaking otherwise. That means you are speaking something dangerous. That means you are not speaking what will have value to your life, or you are not speaking what will promote you, what will elevate you, what will cause you to be outstanding. Hey! There's this scripture that I speak in season and out of season. This is the scripture. This is what I see. The lines are falling for me in pleasant places. I have a good heritage. Here in the United States of America, the lines are falling for me in pleasant places. I have a good heritage. In every part of the world, the lines are falling for me in pleasant places. I have a good heritage. Alone, it's a scripture that God has given me revelation for. I speak it with all faith. And I have been eating there of the fruit. The immigrational lines are falling. The economical lines are falling. Lines in all that has to do with life and godliness, they are falling for me. Jesus is my wisdom. I do not lack wisdom. I always know what to do. Why? Because I have read that Jesus is the embodiment of wisdom. And because I have Jesus in me, I know what to do in this situation. I have wisdom. I have wisdom. I have wisdom. I can never be stranded. Why? Because he has given his angels charge over me. And you speak his word. Even when there's nobody there, or underneath your breath, you are speaking over your children. You are speaking over your finances. You are speaking over your business. You are speaking over your family. You are speaking over the soul of someone who you are trusting to bring to the knowledge of Christ. Do you even have somebody you are trusting to bring to the knowledge of Christ? Or all your request is just about you, your children, your family, and that's all. Excuse me. He said to Abraham, I will bless you and you will be a blessing. He said to Solomon, after Solomon gave so much sacrifice, he said, what do you want? Sacrifice and worship, what do you want? Solomon said, please give me wisdom that I may know how to go in and out before these people which you have made me a leader. Ah! He did not ask for wealth. He did not ask for riches. He knew what to ask for. He said, give me wisdom that I may know how to direct, how to lead these people, that they will be pleasing to you. And the father said, you didn't ask me for any other thing, but you asked me for something that will make you continually pleasing to me. The Bible says there was none who had wisdom like Solomon before him, after him, until Jesus. Until Jesus. What are the things we speak? What are the words we speak? The Bible says in Psalm 112, he said, they will not be afraid of bad news. Sometimes, when something that is not expected and negative happens, what comes to your mind? What do you speak? How do you behave? How do you react? How do you relate? What comes first out of your mouth? Are you panicking or you are just so calm under the shade of the Holy Spirit, knowing that He that is with you is your ever-present help in season and out of season? Somebody that does not sleep nor slumber, he does not doze. When we use the faithless, he has been faithful. That's the person that gave us words. What words do we speak? Even when you are joking, even when you are playing, you don't play with negative words and say, oh no, this is a joke. The Spirit does not care if you are joking or if you are serious. Just say, when that you have been given power, please. There's a place that still baffles me. Not that it baffles me, but it just makes me gentle. When the people that were with Elisha said they wanted to expand where they were living, and they started to cut the tree, and the axe end fell into the river, Elisha said, show me where it fell. He did not dive into the pool to go and he only took a reed. He broke it and said, show me where it fell. And the tree there. And the Bible said, the axe head floated. No wonder Jesus said, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. I was reading, meditating on some scriptures in the book of Kings, first and second. And there is this time, a particular king began to arouse Ahab, began to demand of him, I want this. And Ahab, who is the king, also was saying, okay, I give you that at the point. This king said, you know what? Now, I want to come into your house, and anything that makes you, that gives you joy, I want to give you. That's when Ahab now said, I cannot do that. Every other thing I've asked for, I give it to you. You are not God. You are not all power does not belong to you. He did pray that. So that was what he said. The Bible said that a prophet went to Ahab and said, this king that wants to, that has besieged you, you will defeat him. You will not just defeat him. You will run him over and topple him. And God gave his enemy into the hands of Ahab. And then they are in battle after defeating all the soldiers. Now look, and because this king who had been terrorizing the man fell, I began to say, I'm sorry, forgive you, I'll be your servant. Instead of Ahab who had killed the king, he let the king, he released him in mercy. And then one prophet, this attack they are going. That is just a story I needed to give you the Bible. One prophet who wanted to come and give Ahab a prophecy told one of the other prophets, said, hit me. And the other prophet was like, why would I hit you? I can't hit you. You are a senior prophet. And this senior prophet got angry and said to him, Miranda, for not hitting me, before on your way to your house, a lion will kill you and eat your body. That was what he said. Once And then that guy, on the way to his house, a lion attacked him and ate him. Once. Only once. Once. In Africa, we have some harvest. We have some terrible voodoo people that they will take somebody's picture and they will begin to say negative things into that picture. And the negative things they are saying into this picture will begin to happen to that person in the picture who is not within the shadow or who has not met the Lord God is very pleased. In whatever they tell, the picture is what will be happening to the person. Why? It's not the picture. All they needed was a connection with the spirit of that person. The spirit, the Holy Spirit. And we, children of God, that we know we have this power, we are afraid to use it. Or when we use it, we are not sure. We are doubting it. We are doubting to see the result. Or we don't even know how to speak. We're speaking the wrong words at the right time. Why? Because we are disconnected. Get back into your connection with Father. So that Jesus that said, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. The same is with you. Because you are the light of the world. If you are the light of the world, then it means that whatever you say, have you forgotten? Joshua said to the sun, stand still. Moon, stand still. Why? Because we need to finish this battle. And we need to finish it victoriously. The Bible says, it's still there in the scripture, that the moon stood still and the sun kept shining. And one man spoke. That was Joshua. At least that was Joshua. That's not Jesus. One man spoke. Yes, some of us speak, but we're not speaking as much as we should be speaking. Why? Because we are distracted with the weight of this life, the carrots of this life, the traps that the devil has put in place to distract a lot of people. So it's contending for our attention. When you are waiting on God, God fills your heart. Not only when you're waiting, you can just be doing anything and it begins to speak with you. It begins to speak into your spirit. But because your spirit is elsewhere, you cannot hear him. You're always on the phone. You cannot hear him. Not studying your Bible, reading gossip, rumor, you yourself are gossiping. You are always in a friend. Chit-chatting about that which has no value. You cannot hear it. Because when he's speaking, you are not hearing. And then the little, the shallow part is what you get when you are supposed to be deep. The Bible says he reveals the deep and the secret things. Hey, it is the glory of kings to search. What are we searching? Because the more you know, the more you are able to speak. He said to Peter. Peter said, Jesus, it is you that you have not walked in the water. Tell me to come. And Jesus said, come. He just said, come. He didn't put a plug. He didn't walk a bridge. He just said, come. And all Peter stepped out on was the spoken word. Why? Because that's what became the spirit. And Peter stepped out on him. The Bible did not say it was like. The Bible said it happened. Peter stepped out of the boat and began to walk on water towards Jesus until he turned around and he saw the storm and then he began to sink. That's the kind of distraction I'm talking about. The Bible says that when the seed was planted, some were planted by the roadside, some fell on rocky ground, some fell on the good parts of the soil. And he explained. And then he spoke about one. He said the concerns of life has become a distraction. So that which they hear is trumped by the concerns of life. Because you cannot serve two masters at the same time. It's either you are believing or you are not believing. It's either you have faith or you are faithless. It's either you trust or you don't trust at all. I submit to you today. Jesus said, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. And in Proverbs 18:21, he says the power of life and death is in the tongue. He says, they that do know it will eat the fruits thereof. In other words, they that do know that life is in the tongue, is in speaking, or in the words you speak, and death is in the words you speak, they will eat the fruit. Those that are speaking death will begin to reap the fruits of death. Those that are speaking life will be reaping the fruits of life. But let me tell you how you can speak expressly and accurately. It is when you are plugged into Jesus 24/7, 25/8, 26/9, 1,440 minutes of the 24 hours of the day. Your heart is connected with Him. Irregardless of what you are doing, it will help you to speak a word in season. He said, I have anointed your tongue to speak. If you are not anointed your tongue to speak right, why will He tell you I am? He told Moses, I have anointed Bezalel and Moroni for the work of the curtain of the temple. He didn't come down from heaven. He spoke. He said to Moses, choose 70 elders from the Israelites, and I'm going to take from the spirit that is upon you and put it upon them so that they will be your help, your ministry of help, so that the work will not be too much for you. He spoke. That's the same way people curse each other. That's the same way some people are living in curses or living under curses or in bondage today. And all that you need to do, the Bible says you will know the truth. I have found Jesus. And the Bible says, He that is nailed to the cross on the tree has taken my curses. So, because I have accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior, all these curses are such strong curses. They are taken away from my life, taken away from my children's life. In my family, they don't live beyond 60. In my family, they always fall out of job. In my family, they don't have marriages. In my family, they will be rich and bad. Then they will end up dying for. Get yourself to yourself. This is a curse from hell. Wherever this curse is coming from, I am hidden myself in the cross of Jesus, washed clean by the blood. I have become a new creation in you. All things have passed away. All things have become new. I am a new creation. I am not under any curse any longer. Every curse of my life is broken. Every curse of my generation is broken. All of my children is broken. You are not saying those words as empty words. You are saying those words from revelation that you received in your fellowship with Him. That's why He says, the leper killeth. You can read. Just as some people can call the name of Jesus and nothing happens. Yet, some people will call the name of Jesus and everything will happen. The words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. From this day ends, from this moment, begin to walk first and foremost. Redeem your relationship with Christ. Because He is the vine, you are just a branch. And you cannot do anything. You cannot bring forth any fruit but death outside Him. Get back into yourself. You spend so much time doing everything but fellowshipping with God. And when you begin to fellowship, your mind is already saying, you need to go. You need to get out of it. You need to go. You need to go. You need to go now. You need to go now. You need to go. Where are you going? What if He says today, don't go anywhere. Sit down. Why? You don't have to know why at all times. Because you trust Him who is leading you. The Bible says, as many that are led by the Spirit of God and the Son. And that has nothing to do with gender. Either you are male or female, as many that are led by the Spirit of God, they are the children, sons and daughters of God. He has nothing to do with gender. He has nothing to do with any ethnic group or color. He has to do with the power of God. Not just having the form of godliness and denying his power, but you don't just speak. You speak and your words carry God's power. God bless you. Thank you so much for those of you that are tuned in today, those of you that are here. Thank you so much. Thank you for those of you that are watching me. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you as you get back into fellowship with the Father, as you get connected back to Jesus, as you connect back in fellowship, in koinonia, communion with him. Communion. He's speaking, you are listening, you are speaking, he's hearing, he's talking, he's giving you direction, leading you in the way you should go, leading you by still calm waters, leading you in the way of righteousness, saying to you that even though there's trouble ahead, I'm going to walk you through trouble. It's not that you are going to run from that trouble, I'm going to walk you through that trouble. He says the waters will not carry you away, the fires will not burn you. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. You need to stay tuned. Man shall not live by bread alone. Man shall not live by the physical food or the physical intake we have alone. Man shall not live by the words of the news, the words of the newspapers, the words on social media. Those words are even killing, taking away the peace of human mind, replacing it with fear. And fear is an enemy of God. Fear is meant to paralyze a person or a society. I rebuke every spirit of fear. Did you hear that now? I said I rebuke every spirit of fear, because fear is a spirit. Death is a spirit. Death is a spirit. Sickness and disease is a spirit. I command right now, everyone watching who is sick in their body, I command you, foul spirit, that sickness, disease, and infirmity, get out of this body right now in the name of Jesus. Let there be restoration in this body. Watching or will watch. The crown of your head, soles of your feet. Restoration. Let there be peace that passes human understanding. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just say, thank you, Jesus. Give him praise. Give him praise. Thank you for this word of life that you have, or that you hear, or that you are hearing now. Doesn't matter what part of the world you are watching from, or you have been watching from. These are words of life. These words don't go into extinct. These words don't expire. These words, they are living, and they are life-giving.